my darlings. I think there is still some confusion about these books, and I just, because I feel this is the single finest, most important single volume edition of Lovecraft's fiction, I want to make certain that you get the right one. This is not the right one. This is the first edition, and it is flawed. You can tell the difference because it has gold on the edge of the pages, and it has a gold bookmark, book ribbon. For some reason, this was the first edition of the Barnes and Noble H.P. Lovecraft, The Complete Fiction. And for some reason, this edition, the text is extremely corrupt. And hundreds of typographical errors got into the text. And it's a mystery to me how this happened. So and this is what makes ordering this book kind of sketchy on Amazon, because you don't know which edition you will be getting. The corrected edition came out, when was it, last October? The corrected edition has a silver gilt on its pages, and its book ribbon is purple. And that is how you can tell. Also, it acknowledges Martin Anderson, on the copyright page. That top, the publisher would like, it says, the publisher would like to thank Martin Anderson for his help in the preparation of the text of this edition. Martin Anderson is an amazing young man who went over the entire book, proofread it, and corrected all of the texts. And so this edition of H.P. Lovecraft, The Complete Fiction, with silver gilt and a purple book ribbon, is the definitive single volume edition of the fiction of H.P. Lovecraft. This book contains all of the stories that H.P. Lovecraft wrote on his own. There are no collaborations, with the one exception of Through the Gate. What is it called? Through the Gates of the Silver Key, which is a story that Lovecraft primarily wrote. The main core of the text is by H.P. Lovecraft. It is a story that he wrote with E. Hoffman Price. And this also includes some of Lovecraft's juvenilia. And it has like two versions of the mysterious ship. The second version, the long version, sees its first publication in this book. Its first and only publication in this book. It also has the discarded draft of The Shadow over Innsmouth. And this is a draft of the story in which Lovecraft actually names the narrator who is telling the story, The Shadow Over Innsmouth. It's really fascinating. And it includes scenes that Lovecraft deleted from the completed version of the story. And the book concludes with the wonderful supernatural horror in literature, which is Lovecraft's essay, concerning the weird tale. This is just such a wonderful. This has his early stuff. It has where is it? It has the book, which. Here, let me find it and read what S.C. Joshi, the editor, says. Page 945. I'm going to sneeze. I think I'm allergic to the new cat. The book. This fragment was probably written in late 1933. In a letter of October 1933, Lovecraft wrote, "I am at a sort of standstill in writing, disgusted at much of my older work, and uncertain as to avenues of improvement. In recent weeks, I have done a tremendous amount of experimenting in different styles and perspectives, but have destroyed most of the results." Unquote. Perhaps the book was one of the few items that Lovecraft did not destroy. Its chief point of interest is that it appears to be a prose rendition of the first three sonnets of the Fungi from Yuggoth cycle. These three sonnets, in fact, tell a connected story, but thereafter the cycle appears to become somewhat random, and perhaps Lovecraft did not know how to proceed with the story. The fragment was published in Leaves, 1938. The title is Robert H. Barlow's. This also includes History of the Necronomicon, page 621. History of the Necronomicon, which is not really a short story, but it is a fictive history of Lovecraft's book. Let's read what S.T. Joshi has to say about this. See, each story in the book is prefaced by a synopsis of the text and its history. This story is often considered an essay, but as its contents is entirely fictitious and is indeed meant to be a hoax, it can be regarded as a work of fiction. Lovecraft evidently wrote it in early September 1927, as he told Clark Ashton Smith that he was drawing up some data on the celebrated and unmentionable Necronomicon of the mad Arab Abdul al-Hazred. Lovecraft added at least one sentence referring to John Dee's translation of the Necronomicon at a later date, since he derived this datum from Frank Belknap Long's story, The Space Eaters, read by Lovecraft in late September 1927. It was first published as a pamphlet by Wilson Shepherd in late 1937. I'm wondering, though, if Lovecraft did not write this as a hoax, per se, but that he intended to use the Necronomicon in future stories, and he wanted its history. He wanted to keep things correct, and thus he wrote this history, much in the same manner that he actually designed a map of Arkham, the city of Arkham, so that he could tell, you know, the outline of the city, the street names and all of this. And I think maybe he wrote History of the Necronomicon as a way of keeping track of the history of that book for future reference. This is an amazing collection, and again, it includes only those stories that H.P. Lovecraft wrote by himself. It does not include any of the revisions or collaborations. Those may be found in these two books from Arcane Wisdom. Hello, where's me light? And these books are now available in trade paperback. I saw them available as such at Amazon.com. And these are two volumes of all of the revisions and collaborations annotated by S.T. Joshi. And they're quite wonderful. These are published by Arcane Wisdom Press. We are living in a rich and wonderful era. I've been a Lovecraftian since the early 1970s, and this is the finest time to be a Lovecraftian. We have so much. We have just letters, biographies. We have this wonderful single volume edition of The Case of Charles Dexter Ward. This is just, I keep losing my light because it's nighttime. No, it's too. This is The Case of Charles Dexter Ward, single annotated edition. I had ST sign it. I actually, when I was in hospital last year, and I thought that I was going to die of a heart attack. I had my sister bring me this book so that I could die with this edition of The Case of Charles Dexter Ward on my chest. So this would be, I would be this kind of corpse. This is great. I mean, it's got, you know, a photo of H.P. Lovecraft. And then at the back, it's got photos of places mentioned in the novels. And then at the bottom are those portions of the novel that mention these sites. It's an amazingly wonderful edition of The Case of Charles Dexter Ward. We have so much, and it just doesn't stop. It just doesn't stop. I think that's why I'm able to just overflow with energy and ideas for my own Lovecraftian books, my collections of Lovecraftian weird fiction. We are being fed and so well nourished that those of us who write Lovecraftian fiction and mythos fiction, we have this unending delight, delicious diet of things that to inspire us. This is the best time to be a fan of H.P. Lovecraft. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. So, anyway, I hope you all are having a wonderful evening, darlings, and I'll talk to you later. Shalom, my ducks.